100 Quotes by Alexis de Tocqueville, narrated by Brad Carty. I go back from century to century to the remotest antiquity. I see nothing that resembles what is before my eyes. The past no longer illuminates the future. The mind walks in darkness. The French still count on a power they hate to save themselves, but saving themselves is the last thing on their mind. Freedom does not exist without morality, nor morality without faith. Democratic peoples have a natural taste for equality. They want it in freedom, and if they cannot obtain it, they still want it in slavery. History is a gallery of paintings where there are few originals and many copies. Education, as well as charity, has become a national affair for most people today. The state receives and often takes the child from its mother's arms and entrusts it to its agents. It is the state that takes charge of inspiring feelings and providing ideas to each generation. Uniformity reigns in studies, as in everything else. Diversity, like freedom, disappears every day. There is more light and wisdom in many men together than in one. The taste for public service and the desire to live off taxes is France's greatest and permanent infirmary. Tyrants are great only because we are on our knees. The concentration of power and individual servitude will therefore grow in democratic nations, not only in proportion to equality, but because of ignorance. The slave is a servant who does not argue and submits to everything without murmuring. Sometimes he murders his master, but he never resists him. Only God can be all-powerful without danger. He who seeks in freedom something other than himself is made to serve. The despots themselves do not deny that freedom is excellent. They only want it for themselves, and they maintain all others are utterly unworthy of it. Great men are passionate about the little things when they miss the big things. In democracies, each generation is a new people. One must not despise man if one wants to obtain great efforts from others and from oneself. In politics, what is often the most difficult to appreciate and understand is what is going on before our eyes. I regard as unholy and detestable the maxim that in matters of government, the majority of a people has the right to do everything. What then is a majority taken collectively, if not an individual who has opinions and most often interests contrary to another individual who is called the minority? Democracy extends the sphere of individual independence. Socialism tightens it. Democracy gives all its possible value to each man. Socialism makes each man an agent, an instrument, a figure. Democracy and socialism stand by only one word, equality. But notice the difference. Democracy wants equality in liberty, and socialism wants equality in genetics and servitude. This state wants to be so benevolent towards its citizens that it intends to substitute itself for them in the organization of their own lives. Will it go so far as to prevent them from living in order to better protect them from themselves? What the vulgar man calls wasted time is very often time gained. The most dangerous moment for a bad government is usually when it begins to reform. Why shouldn't the rule that applies to one man be equally applicable to all others? In politics, the community of hatreds almost always forms the basis of friendships. If someone were to show me, between complete independence and the complete enslavement of thought, an intermediate position where I could hope to stand, I might establish myself there. But who will discover this intermediate position? What a sad thing that all over the earth governments are always precisely as naughty as the morals of their subjects may allow them to be. That same equality which makes the individual independent of each of his fellow citizens, in particular the isolated and defenseless, book to the action of the greatest number. Men cannot enjoy political liberty without buying it by a few sacrifices, and they never seize it except with great effort. Providence has created the human race neither entirely independent nor entirely enslaved. It does, it is true, trace around every man a fatal circle from which he cannot escape. But, within its vast limits, man is powerful and free. So are peoples. As far as the press is concerned, there is certainly no middle ground between servitude and license. In order to reap the priceless goods that freedom of the press assures, one must know how to submit to the inevitable evils that it brings about. There are nowadays many people who are very easily accommodated to this kind of compromise between administrative despotism and the sovereignty of the people, and who think that they have sufficiently guaranteed the freedom of individuals, when it is to the national power that they deliver it. This is not enough for me. The nature of the master is far less important to me than obedience. There are, in general, only simple conceptions that seize the spirit of a people. A false idea, but clear and precise, will always have more power in the world than a true but complex idea. I know of no country where the love of money holds a greater place in the heart of man, and where a deeper contempt for the theory of the permanent equality of goods is professed than in the United States. But fortune flows with incredible speed, and experience teaches that it is rare to see two generations collecting favors. In times of aristocracy, each man is always very closely related to several of his fellow citizens, so that one man cannot be attacked and others cannot come to his aid. In centuries of equality, each individual is naturally isolated. He has no hereditary friends whose help he can demand, no class whose sympathies are assured. He is easily set apart and is trampled underfoot with impunity. Nowadays, therefore, a citizen who is oppressed has only one means of defending himself. It is to address the whole nation, and, if it is deaf to him, the human race. He has only one means of doing so, and that is the press. The first, and in some ways the only necessary condition to achieve centralization of public power in a democratic society, is to love equality or to make people believe it. Thus the science of despotism, so complicated in the past, becomes simpler. It is reduced, so to speak, to a single principle. As citizens become more equal and more alike, the inclination of each one to blindly believe a certain man or a certain class diminishes. The willingness to believe the mass increases, and it is more and more opinion that leads the world. Equality produces, in fact, two tendencies. One leads men directly to independence and can suddenly push them to anarchy. The other leads them along a longer, more secret, but safer path to servitude. Most believe that the government is acting badly, but all believe that the government must constantly act and put its hand out. In America, the majority draws a formidable circle around thinking. Within these limits, the writer is free, but woe to him if he dares to break out of it. Chains and executioners are the crude instruments once used by tyranny, but nowadays civilization has perfected to the point of despotism itself, which seems to have nothing more to learn. The princes had, so to speak, materialized violence. The democratic republics of today have made it just as intellectual as the human will it seeks to coerce. Under the absolute government of one, despotism, in order to reach the soul, roughly struck the body. And the soul, escaping these blows, rose gloriously above it. But in the democratic republics, this is not how tyranny proceeds. It leaves the body and goes straight to the soul. Thus, it is not always the same class of citizens that applies itself to increasing the prerogatives of power. But as long as the democratic revolution lasts, there is always a class in the nation that is powerful by number or by wealth, which special passions and particular interests lead to centralizing public administration, regardless of hatred for the government of one's neighbor, which is a general and permanent feeling among democratic peoples. We forget that it is, especially in the detail, dangerous to enslave men. I, for my part, would be inclined to believe that freedom is less necessary in the great things than in the lesser ones, if I thought that one could never be assured of one without possessing the other. In the past, the sovereign lived on the income of his lands or on the proceeds of taxes. It is no longer the same today that his needs have grown with his power. In the same circumstances where once a prince would establish a new tax, today a loan is used. Little by little, the state thus becomes the debtor of most of the rich. In the 18th century, it was no longer the people themselves who formed the General Assembly. This one is almost always representative. But what must be taken into account is that nowhere is it elected by the mass of the public and receives the spirit of the assembly. A nation tired of long debates willingly consents to be fooled, as long as it is put down again, and history teaches us that it is then sufficient to content itself with gathering from all over the country a certain number of obscure and dependent men to make them play before it the role of a political assembly in return for.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.